In the previous video, we found the magnetic field inside and outside a current-carrying wire with uniform current density. Now, as promised, in this video, we're going to compute the magnetic field inside and outside a thick wire with non-uniform current density. So in this case, we're told the current density grows linearly as k times r, where r is the distance from the symmetry axis of the wire, and k is a constant carrying the necessary units to make J work out to amps per square meter. So at the center, the current density J is zero, and then it grows to a maximum value at the surface of the wire where the distance from the axis is big R. Now, just like in the previous video, we start working on the calculation of magnetic field within the wire by using Ampere's law. And that magnetic field swirls around the symmetry axis of the cylinder according to a right-hand rule, so we define our Amperian loop as a circular path sharing the same symmetry, and we can see that Amperian loop in the diagram already with a radius of little r. Now, just like in the previous video, the Ampere's law path integral is going to be trivial because for every tiny increment of length along the Amperian loop, the magnetic field B is parallel to that increment, and the magnitude of B is constant along the loop as well. What changes in this problem is that our non-uniform current density actually throws a pretty terrible wrench in the gears, because when we apply Ampere's law within the volume of the wire, the calculation of enclosed current requires a physical integral over the surface defined by the Amperian loop. So to see what's going on here, we need to start with a quick reminder of the concept of current density. And that's the current per unit cross-sectional area. We can turn that definition around and say that the current is the current density multiplied by the cross-sectional area. Now, if the current density was constant, we'd be able to compute any enclosed current in an Amperian loop by simply multiplying the constant J times the area of the loop. Unfortunately, over the area in our Amperian loop, J doesn't have just one value. It's continuously changing from zero at the center to a maximum value of k little r at the edge of the Amperian loop, so this multiplication no longer makes any sense. What we need to do to find enclosed current now is to slice the area into thin rings so that J has a well-defined value over the area contained within the width of each ring. So that's what one of the rings looks like in perspective, but it's probably wise to look at a face-on view as well. So in the face-on view, we see our Amperian loop of radius little r inside the wire, which has a radius of big R. And we're breaking the area inside the Amperian loop into these thin rings of radius little r prime. That prime is just to distinguish between the two types of little r's. And each ring then has a thickness that we'll call dr prime. And again, the whole point of this is that we want to compute the total current enclosed within the Amperian loop. And we can quickly get the current contribution to the total enclosed current for this little thin ring slice by just modifying our current density formula into infinitesimal form. So we're going to say that the infinitesimal contribution to the enclosed current, dI enclosed, is equal to J times dA, where dA is the area of that thin ring wall. And now it is legal to simply take the current density and multiply by the area to get the enclosed current contribution, because J has a single well-defined value of K times R prime inside the infinitesimally thin ring. So there we've replaced the J with a K times little r prime. Now the last thing we need to do to set up an integral for enclosed current is express the incremental area dA in terms of r prime. And that's just the circumference of that ring multiplied by its thickness, or 2 pi times r prime times dr prime. So now we have an expression for dI enclosed, where I've moved all the constants to the front, that's 2 times pi times k, and I move the r primes together, so we have an r prime squared, and then we multiply by dr prime. So we're finally ready to calculate the enclosed current for the right-hand side of Ampere's law. And this is where I get out my trusty yellow pen, because we're finally ready to just grind through some calculus. So we're going to start by adding up all these contributions to the enclosed current within the Amperian loop. What we're trying to find is I enclosed, and that's just the sum of all the contributions to I enclosed. This is what an integral does. It just adds up a bunch of continuously changing infinitesimal contributions and tells you what the total is. So we have the integral of dI enclosed, and now we can just sub in our expression for dI enclosed, that's 2 pi k times r prime squared dr prime. Again, the prime is just to distinguish the two types of little r's. It has nothing to do with the derivative. And we want to add up all these contributions as our rings go from the center of the wire to the edge of the Amperian loop, where r prime is equal to little r. So we're going from 0 to little r. And this is a simple integral because it's just the integral of a variable squared. That gives us 1/3 times that variable cubed. So we end up with a 2/3 times pi k r prime cubed evaluated from 0 to little r. When we sub in the lower limit, we get 0 out of that, so we're not concerned with that. We're just going to replace the r prime with a little r. Okay, so there it is, an expression for the total enclosed current within an Amperian loop of radius little r, where that little r is less than big R, the radius of the wire. And unfortunately, we're not done yet, because our goal here is to express the magnetic field in terms of the total current in the wire, which is big I. In other words, we're trying to get rid of that little k. We don't want our final answer in terms of k. And the way to get a handle on this is to just compute the total enclosed current in the wire with a similar integral, where we add up all the contributions from the center of the wire all the way to the outside edge. And when we do that, we should get the total current enclosed in the wire, and we'll be able to relate that to k. So the total current in the wire is going to be an integral over all the enclosed current contributions, the same kind of thing, except this time we're going to go all the way from 0 to big R. And nothing changes about the mechanics of the integral here. We're going to end up with an r prime cubed over 3 for the antiderivative in there. So our total antiderivative comes out to the exact same expression as it did before. The only thing that changes is that we're going to sub in a big R for r prime. So we end up with a total current of 2/3 pi k big R cubed. So then generally what your plan is here is to solve for that k in terms of the total current in the wire and then sub it in to the expression for the current enclosed in the Amperian loop. But in this case, the two expressions are so close to each other that we may as well just solve for 2/3 pi k, and that's going to be I over big R cubed. So again, 2/3 pi k can be replaced with a big I divided by big R cubed, and we're going to do that to this expression for enclosed current. So making that replacement, I have a big I over big R cubed times little r cubed, and now we've got a useful expression for the total current enclosed in our Amperian loop. Now, of course, the whole point of computing the enclosed current is that we're trying to apply Ampere's law. So going back to Ampere's law real quick, we have that the integral of B dotted into dl along our Amperian loop is equal to mu naught times the enclosed current. And here's a quick reminder in the diagram of what that vector B looks like and what the vector dl looks like. Now, we're integrating in the natural direction according to the right-hand rule. So in our picture, the current is coming out at us, so we put our thumb in the direction of that current and the fingers of our right hand wrap around counterclockwise. That's going to be the direction of the magnetic field. So every one of these little path increments, dl, is tangential to this Amperian loop, and so is the magnetic field vector. So as always, the path integral in Ampere's law is going to be trivial. The dot product reduces to the product of the two magnitudes of these vectors because they're pointing in the same direction. So I end up with an integral of just B times dl. But then the second point is that the magnitude of the magnetic field is going to be constant along this entire loop as well, so we can factor it out of the integral. And I end up with a B in front of the integral of dl. But the integral of dl is just the total length of the loop, which is the circumference. So I end up with B times 2 pi little r. And this is equal to the right-hand side of Ampere's law, which is mu naught times I enclosed. So now we can finally sub in the I enclosed that we obtained from these physical integrals, and we end up with B times 2 pi r is equal to mu naught on the right hand side of Ampere's law times I enclosed, which can then be written as I times little r cubed over big R cubed. Now we can cancel one of the little r's out, leaving us with two of those in the numerator. And we can finally solve for B, and we're going to call this B sub n, because this is inside the wire. So B sub n turns out to be mu naught I times little r squared divided by 2 pi times big R cubed, where big R is the radius of the wire. So that's really the meat of the problem. We found a quadratically increasing magnetic field within the wire, and we can compare that to the previous result we got for uniform current density, where the magnetic field turned out to be increasing linearly within the wire. So I'm pretty sure I see a pattern here. Like, if I made a new problem with quadratically increasing current density, I would expect to see cubically increasing magnetic field strength. Now that's the main part of the problem, but for completeness, we should also state the magnetic field outside the wire. But that one is trivial. An Amperian loop outside the wire contains all the current, the entire capital I. So we quickly apply Ampere's law one more time. And on the left-hand side, the exact same thing happens to make that integral trivial. That's going to be a B times 2 pi R. And on the right-hand side, the enclosed current is just the total current. Again, I'm imagining surrounding the entire wire with a second Amperian loop with a radius larger than big R. We end up with this classic result, the same thing we got for a thin wire and the same thing we got outside of our last thick wire with uniform current density. It just keeps coming out to mu naught I over 2 pi times little r, the distance from the center of the wire. So now we know the magnetic field for all regions in space around this wire with non-uniform current density. So here's a summary of the magnetic field inside and outside the wire. And it's interesting to investigate what happens at the surface of the wire by evaluating each of these expressions when little r is equal to big R. In other words, when we're located at the surface of the wire. So Bn evaluated at capital R. Well, we just replace our little r with a big R there, and we see that we'll get a big R squared in the numerator. Two of those are going to cancel out the big R's in the denominator, and this reduces to mu naught I over 2 pi times big R. Now, if we do the same replacement in our expression for B out, the magnetic field magnitude outside the wire, we replace the little r with a big R, and we arrive at exactly the same expression. Mu naught I over 2 pi R. So another way to say this is that we expect our magnetic field magnitude to be continuous at the surface of the wire. So finally, we bring in a plot of our magnetic field magnitude. So there it is, it's quadratically increasing from the center of the wire all the way until we get to where little r is equal to big R. In other words, at this dashed line, we're talking about the surface of the wire. After that, for larger values of little r, we see this 1 over r drop off, and the field is asymptotically going to zero in the long run. This video is part of a series on Ampere's law, and that playlist is linked at the lower left. In the next video, we're going to look at the magnetic field generated by a thick cylindrical shell conductor with uniform current density. I'll post a link to that video at the upper left when it's done, and I'll see you there.